flying around-the-clock strikes, 52s concentrate on Iraq's Republican Guard. The mission rate is intense. On average, bombers arrive over enemy positions every hour and a half for 5 straight weeks. Bomber crews do not come through the war unscathed. Early on, engine failure claims a Stratofortress on final approach. Of the 6 on board, 3 eject safely, 3 perish. Later, a B-52 is struck by 2 surface-to-air missiles. Miraculously, its crew survives.
It was just a mission to cut a rail intersection to block the any possible retreat of the Republican Guards up near the Basra area. About a minute and a half after the target is when we first got the indication that there was some surface-to-air missile threats in the area. The Iraqis had gotten pretty smart, and they did not turn their radars on for any length of time. What I think happened was that they had highlighted the first 2 aircraft that had gone by to try to get some information as far as azimuth and altitude. And then when the 3rd ship came by, they highlighted again just momentarily and fired off a salvo of at least 4 missiles that we're aware of, and possibly 5. The thing that probably helped us the most was that early in the war, I learned that you don't follow the aircraft in front of you, so we were offset quite a bit from that aircraft.
It was a classic SA-2 engagement, the same type of thing we trained for back in the States on our missions and in our simulators. I notified the crew immediately, began the countermeasures against it.
Everything was pretty much uneventful up until bombs away. The airplane shuddered like we were releasing another weapon. You know, the radar navigator had, and I confirmed that all the weapons were off, so nothing was hanging. And that, at that point, we knew we'd taken at least one hit. It was followed very quickly by a second shudder. We knew we'd taken the second hit.
Suddenly, the rest of the crew started reporting the damage and loss of systems on the airplane. We kind of realized that the situation was really deteriorating rapidly.
Quickly checked my personal equipment, tightened up my parachute tighter than it already was, got my helmet cinched down tighter, and basically, in my mind, reviewed the ejection procedures.
The wounded bomber, spewing fuel from shrapnel hits along its wing, is nursed home by its crew.
My biggest concern was the structural integrity of the wings of this aircraft. As you know, it's built so that the fuel provides most of the structural ability in that wing. And with that going out pretty quickly, I was concerned about lowering the flaps. When we did get down on the ground and the wings flexed down as they do when we slow down, the number one main tank began to empty out at a very excessive rate. And we stopped the aircraft, and the firemen came in and they hosed it down and plugged the leak. I think I'll personally send a thank you note to Mr. Boeing, who designed this airplane, because it held together really well. I wasn't too concerned about the situation until I read the maintenance report of all the near misses and the possible damage that could have been done, and the over 65 holes that were in the airplane. When I saw that, man, I wished I could have had a cold drink of some kind.